In the men's room is what it is. I'm Onimisi Adaba, and I trust you're doing well. Very good, as a matter of fact. Yeah? Okay. What, you enjoyed last week, right? Yes, indeed. RMD in the building shared thoughts from the privacy of his heart. What he could share, actually, you know, and I think it went well. But guess what? I have another guy in the building. Fantastic guy, great guy, and we'll be doing the same thing in a different way. Who? No, not yet. Just stay. We'll go on a quick break, and when we come back, I'll let you in on who we have in the men's room tonight. Stay with us. So if you're just hooking up, you're right on time. Just about to start taking off on what we have for you tonight in the men's room. I'm Onimisi Adaba, and... Okay, I know you're there. Thank you. I know. Calm down. Easy. All right. So tonight, we're just going to have a conversation, just like we did last week with our guest. Conversation around a whole lot of things about us men as in relations to family, to the business, you know, the marketplace, and faith and every other thing. And the fundamental thing there, bottom line, is just to pick a thing or two. You know, learn a thing or two from, you know, some of these guys that I'll be bringing, or all of them, you know, that there's always a starting point, yeah? So wherever you are, whatever you're doing, it's rough, it's tough, it's crazy, it's a starting point. And these days where people jump off the bridge and commit all kinds of crazy things we call suicide, there's no need for that, yeah? Life comes with its own rough, tough, and crazy times. We can live through it and pull through it. And that's why we're all here. To tap from each other, our energies, and just know that it's going to be all right. So tonight with me, I have none other than, you know how it is when you have a big name here and you're wondering how to introduce this person, how, you know, the appropriate way. But then again, I realized keeping it simple just makes a whole lot of difference. He goes by the name Ike. Yeah? Ike, thank you so much for coming.
Pleasure to be here, man.
Matter of fact, it's Ikomusa Osakioduwa.
My goodness. Very good effort. It took me years to learn as well. I never expect anything from anybody concerning that name. Yeah, so.
Ikomusa. What does it mean? What does the first name mean?
Ikomusa means I thank God. Hmm. And then Osakioduwa means God has the keys to, or God opens the way to wealth or affluence.
My goodness. And he sure has done that for you.
Well, he's I can't tell you a lie. Once, since I it wasn't my original surname. Mm-hmm. Since I changed my surname, things have been opening up and working.
Why did you change your surname?
My last surname wasn't a name that I wanted to be called by, because I think it went against my Christian faith. Mm-hmm. My last surname was of Yahweh.
Okay. Right?
Now, when you break it down into the syllabic pronunciation, is supposed to be Obiaiwe, which is a pledge of allegiance to Obia, which is not a god but a goddess.
There we go.
Right?
Mm-hmm. There we go.
So the backstory is somebody in the family must have offended the goddess, uh-huh. And then this guy in the family stands up and says, listen, I'm not there. And it's a pledge of allegiance saying, listen, I am your guy. You know, so it's a strong pledge of allegiance to a goddess, which I didn't want. I didn't know how I'd go around telling people I was a Christian, but, you know, my surname is something that goes towards praising a goddess. So I thought, you know,
yeah, we've had a bunch of people change their surnames or their names, you know, for one reason or the other and all of that. And Sakyudua sounds Japanese, yeah?
I know. You know, it wasn't the name I would have picked. quite frankly, when I thought about changing my name, I thought, okay, go with you. Just take your dad's first name. That's what most people do. So my dad's first name is Samuel.
Oh, okay.
And my dad was like, there's no way any of my children is going to have an English surname.
Yeah.
You know, because none of us in my family have English names. Mm. And my dad gave us all Edo names from start to finish. So like, there's no way any of my children is going to be called Samuel, you know. And then he decided, I thought, okay, let me take your middle name. And my dad was like, it's not nice, it's not powerful, it's not, I don't know, you know. And then my mom heard the name somewhere, and she said, how about this name, Osakioduwa? My dad was like, I don't know. And he took 8 years to decide on it.
Really? So within
within that time, I was in the process of waiting for the change. I wanted his blessing with it. I didn't want to just pick a random name.
Yes.
So I wanted him to bless the name and say, you know, you have my blessing to go mm-hmm. do this. Mm-hmm. And so eventually he approved the name. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Osakioduwa.
Nice. You sound like you guys were closely knit. What was it like growing up?
Oh, it was interesting. My dad and mom were best friends, you know.
Wow.
Best friends. And they have an interesting love story. You know? Mm. He fell in love with this beautiful girl. He was her lecturer.
Really?
He was, yeah. She, you know, when he was, you know, when you graduated from a university, you've done very well.
Mm-hmm.
And then all of a sudden they say, you'll stay back and teach for a while. So he was her lecturer.
Yeah.
You know, and then eventually the two of them fell in love.
Mm.
And he decided, okay, let's go ahead with this marriage. But then somehow, she fell ill at one point and was told she would never have children, you know, and they took her everywhere, you know, then the big hospitals, UCH, Ibadan, different places, Benin, and then they flew her to Austria, to London, and everywhere the report was the same thing, you'll never have kids. So she came back from this situation and said to him, listen, I'm never going to have kids. Maybe you should find a real wife that mm-hmm. could be your whatever. He's like, you know, who are these people telling you this? And she's like, the best doctors available. And he said, you know what? I'm not chasing you for kids. It's you that I fall in love with. I'm going to marry. And then a few years into the marriage, they have the first child, second child, third child, fourth child, and then the fifth child. So their friendship after that just became unbelievable.
Yeah.
They were inseparable till the day my mom passed. They used to eat out of the same plate every meal. You know, we used to think it was cheesy and corny, but I see the merits of it nowadays when I'm older. But they used to eat out of the same plate. They would quarrel and then in the evening settle it. So we the kids fed off that relationship, and they used to tell us, you know, you can never be one of us. You know, you can't be part of this marriage. Mm. You know, like it's my wife and I, my husband and I.
Yes.
And so you guys have to be close to each other the way we are close to each other. So I grew up a family of five, you know, in terms of siblings. There's four siblings and me. We were real close because we thought, look, you have to have each other's back. And we moved, we're an army family, so we moved around a lot. We were always the new kids in school.
Mm-hmm.
So we got used to being friends with each other, because many times you get to the new schools and you don't have any friends for a year or two.
You end up falling back on yourself.
Yeah, so we were very close in the family.
Great. Good to know. Now, we started off with your name, you know, Osakioduwa, the other one that you didn't want and all of that. But Wild Child was somewhere in the mix.
Yeah.
So, and then there was a transition. So who is Wild Child? Or who was Wild Child? And now we have Ike.
You know what it was? I wanted to do radio at the start of my career. After getting out of university, or even while I was in university, I was auditioning in different places. And there were a few names on radio that, just a few, a handful, quite frankly. And, you know, everybody knew those names because there were not many of them, maybe five big names on radio. And unfortunately for me, one of the big names on radio was a guy called Ike. I think he was on this station on a Sunday. He used to host a Sunday show, I can't remember. But on one of the radio stations, he was, there was a guy called Ike, and he was kind of popular. He wasn't big like the mainstream morning show presenters, but there was somebody there. So I thought, if I come into this business with the name Ike, everybody's first of all going to go, oh, which Ike? And I'm like, no, not him.
And you start explaining.
And then I start explaining, and I don't want to be the wannabe Ike, so that's what, I need a different name. My middle name is too long and dangerous to use on the radio. My middle name is Omoihudu. Like, I mean, I don't know what my parents are thinking.
You know, and what does that mean?
I have no idea. I tried to, my mom struggled to explain it to me. She was
it's
someone that
like
doesn't
that.
Have children that thinks too deeply. So it means something along that line.
There we go.
I was like, why would you sentence me to a sentence? You know, like, you know, as a meaning of a name. Like, that's so long. I couldn't use that one, obviously, so I thought for a while, and I came up with a concept of defining my personality in a name.
Yeah.
And I wanted to be wild, not wild as in like chaotic and badly behaved, but untamed. You know, an animal in its true state is untamed.
Mm-hmm.
It has what we call wild animals are actually animals in their true state, in their true state of mind, you know, who deliver their lifestyles according to their nature.
Yes.
You know?
The way they are.
The way they, exactly. Yeah. But when you tame them and take them out of their environment, then they become tame animals, but then I wanted to be wild, be in a sense untamed and unconditioned and different from other people, be Ike, you know. So I wanted to be that guy who would come onto radio and be Ike, you know, just do me, or be wild in the sense of being free. And then the child came from the concept of, I have very little inhibition. You know how children, if they're falling, will grab the closest adult. They don't care if they know you. You know, if they're hungry, they'll tell somebody. If they need to use the bathroom, they'll look at somebody who looks responsible and say, hey, hello, I need to pee. You know, and they will ask for help, or they will say their mind on an issue. If you ask them, why don't you come to my house anymore? I don't like you. You know, they'll say
straight it. No inhibitions. Very
no inhibitions. So I thought to myself, it would be refreshing to have somebody like that on the radio. I wanted to be that guy, the guy who would come out and say what he was thinking without apologies, you know, be innocent about it, but be honest, you know. So I would come out and say, hey, I saw a beautiful girl today and all I could think about was why I didn't get her number. And I wanted to be that guy who could say the things
that people were thinking. Wouldn't say.
Or wouldn't say.
Yeah.
You know, so that's what that was all about. And I did that for a few years until I rebranded.
And I wonder why you rebranded.
Okay, well, rebranding for me was, it started, the thought about rebranding had been on in my mind. I had been thinking about, I can't be Wild Child forever. And the, by the end of the period while I was called Wild Child, the name had grown so big, it had overshadowed me as an individual. So I would go places.
You had done a good job.
I had done a good job with the brand, you know, so I would go to the bank and they would be attending to me and treating me badly. And then someone would say, hey, watch out. And they'd be like, ah, is that you? Oh, come, this. And then they would fast track the process for me. And I thought, you know, this is, it's a good brand, but it's not delivering in the areas where I need it to deliver. Because I can't put it on an official document when I'm traveling.
Okay.
I can't, you know, identify myself by it to the policeman who stopped me on the road. I can't pass it on to my children. So the thought had been in my mind about rebranding, but I never took it too seriously. One day, my pastor calls me and he's like, look, dude, this name is just, it's just not
working.
It's
too wild.
It's just not working. People are misinterpreting the name, which was also something that was happening very seriously at the time.
You know, you saying what you said now, you know, gives perspective.
Yeah.
Because it just put, I didn't think in this line.
Yeah.
Of Wild Child.
Yeah.
So, yes. A whole lot of misinterpretation.
Yeah, and a lot of people. Everybody was misinterpreting the name. He called me, he was like, why do you have this name? And I told him. And I was like, but everybody's completely misinterpreting it right
That's
now.
That's right.
And I would meet people and they would try to be crazy simply because they heard I was called Wild Child. I'm like, why are you doing these silly things that you're doing? And they're like, hey, but you're the Wild Child, you should get it. I'm like, yeah, but I'm not being outrageous, I'm being real. You know, so the thoughts have been on, and then he calls me and he says to me, you know, this name is putting you in quite a bit of trouble, you know, people misinterpreting it, and blah, blah. He was like, yeah, you might want to think about rebranding. You know, he didn't say rebrand. He just said, you might want to think about it. There are merits to, you know, using a name that is healthy or helpful. So I left that meeting thinking, okay, fine, I'll get to it eventually. Maybe in a year or two, I'll rebrand. But then something drastic happened to me shortly after that meeting. I had been called to MC for one of the banks, you know, and they submitted my name as Wild Child. And the man, the owner of the bank, God bless him, looked at the proposal from the event planner and said, what rubbish is this? Did you not know that this was the MDCEO's event? You are bringing a child, a wild child, to come and host it? What rubbish? Take that name off and find me another MC. So they didn't argue. They apologized. They struck the name off. Then they wrote in Ike Osakioduwa. And he said, hey,
now we're talking.
Now we're talking. I don't know this boy, but at least I can tell that his head is on his shoulders. You know, so as soon as that happened to me, I realized
lights came on.
This what my pastor had mentioned to me was real. That this is going to be a problem. You know, if I keep it up, I wouldn't get the corporate gigs. There's some jobs that they'd be afraid to commission me because they would think I'm a problem. So I immediately went back to using my original name.
The power of the name, the effect of the name, amazing. Have you always been like this? I mean, there you are. Okay, before asking that, how did you get into radio? I mean, once upon a time you were, you guys faked it, or you faked it with your with your family and
yeah,
all
we used to do that.
They pretend, like I say with my kids and all of that. So this had been in you, right?
Yeah. And I, when I was younger, I used to say I would one day own a radio station. Still working on that dream.
Mm. It's possible.
Yeah. Mm. You know, I used to say that when I was a lot younger, you know, maybe 8, 9. Mm. So we would make radio show recordings.
But why? Were you exposed to it earlier? Or
no,
it just...
Funny enough, I don't remember even ever really listening to the radio. The only radio we got to listen to, my dad was very old school, so he used to have these transistor radios with shortwave and SW1 and you know, and where BBC would come on and the bell, they, you know, and you know, then the introduction of the BBC. So those are the only radio presenters I actually interacted with or got to hear from when I was a child. So I really can't explain why we used to make those radio recordings.
I mean, for me, I got exposed to the behind the scenes early enough. You know, my dad would take us to, then in NTA, take us to the office, go to the studios, and we see a whole lot of behind the scenes, and, you know, a couple of them documentaries, no, series and dramas were done, you know, some were done in my house then. So we saw a whole lot of these things, and, you know, it got us thinking.
So you acquired the taste early.
Yeah, yeah, we are. But for you, I mean, it was just
Random.
From nowhere.
Completely random. I don't remember what listening to any radio growing up, other than my dad's news, transistor radio. So I don't know where that came from, but we used to do it. We would play songs, we would introduce music, we would do interviews, random things, and we would do it with this deck that had the record button, record and play, you know, thing. And it was a shoddy job. It was terrible, you know, growing up. In terms of those, the quality of the productions, I don't have any of those tapes still.
Yeah.
But the quality of the production was terrible. You would hear the clicking of the radio as well, when pressing record and stuff. You hear people laughing in the background. There's just no class to it whatsoever. But we're kids, so it's all good.
And then over time, you are this big brand now. I mean, not just a radio man, but you're hosting shows, you're hosting gigs, you're on TV. I like your show.
Thanks.
I like highlights with Heike.
Yeah,
fantastic
piece
you've got there.
Thank you.
Has it always been like this? I mean, talk us through some of your rough, tough, and crazy times.
Oh, no, it hasn't always been like this. I remember my first 6 months on the radio were hectic. I had auditioned for about 4 or 5 months before then to get into radio.
Mm-hmm.
I had gone everywhere. I've been to all the radio stations around at that time, which was basically Rhythm Cool, AIT, or rather Ray Power.
Ray Power.
You know, and I checked it. I didn't want to work for the government ones. So I tried. I had eventually settled down into the Rhythm reception and decided I was just going to be there every day. So I did that for about 3 months, going there
really?
Every day. Yeah.
Just the reception. Be
just
there
the
every
reception.
Day.
Be there every day, and one day I would go to reception and ask to see the head of production. He was, at that time, the way the structure was, the head of production was the head of programs, he was the head of the radio station.
Mm.
So the first day I got there, I wanted to see the GM. They were like, GM?
Who are you?
So I'm like, who's in charge of the radio station? And the lady was like, that would be the head of production. So I was like, okay, I want to see the head of production. And they're like, okay. What about? And I told them, and they somehow got me into a meeting with him. He said, do you have a demo? I said, no. He said, go record the demo. I recorded the demo, came back, we listened to the demo. He said, you know, that I found the demo really interesting, but this is a very playful sound that I don't know that it would sell on the radio, and I don't think you could get the callers to be that loose with you. So he said, but it's a nice, you know, thing, but yeah. So, we don't even have any space. So I decided I would keep going back. For 3 months, I would go every day, and he would. I'd ask to see him, and he was like, "Why are you doing this? I told you there's no space in Lagos. We have no space in Abuja. What are you hoping for?" I said, well, one day somebody's going to be late for work. Somebody's going to be upset you. Somebody's going to get fired. And on that day, I don't want you to look far. I want you to look in your reception and find the replacement. Get that guy from the reception.
Yeah.
You know. And he laughed, and he let me keep coming to the reception, but he stopped seeing me. You know. And how I got the job was even kind of random. It wasn't even him that hired me. What happened was somebody else. I had distributed my demo everywhere to anybody who had any knowledge of entertainment. I'd hand you my demo. And a friend of mine was trying to pitch doing a what they call it, the a website mm-hmm. for the station, mm-hmm. and I decided, okay, let me you know, give you my demo. I gave him my demo. He listened to it. And I'm like, oh yeah, you sound good. Somehow during his presentation to the boss, my demo played, and which was just a hand of God. And the president of the company said, what? Who is this guy? Is this one of mine? And they're like, no.
Some random guy.
And they're like, he's probably in your reception. Unfortunately, that day I was in school doing my clearance, and they called me. They're like, you know what? You have a job. Come through. And that's how I got the job. But my first 6 months on the radio, I didn't get paid any money.
Wow.
I wasn't paid a dime. I was coming every day. I was understudying somebody who wasn't excited about me either. And he told me, shut up. They introduced me. They said, oh, this is IK. He's going to be understudying you, you know, and teach him to use the system, you know.
Show him the rope.
And do this. And so he said, oh, sure. Cool. Wonderful. Yeah, thank you. And as soon as the gentleman who introduced me to him walked out, he said, listen to me. You will shut up. You will sit down in that corner, and you will not speak until you're spoken to.
Yeah.
And I did that for a while. You know,
a while was 6 months?
6 months. You know, I sat down
so this
in the corner.
3 months at the reception.
3 months at the
six
reception.
Months
6 months
just sitting
shutting
there,
up.
Shutting up. Not doing anything.
Not doing anything. And I wasn't learning as much as I should, because I was watching from, the studio was really big. So I was sitting in, literally in the corner.
Mm.
And I would see him go, switch off the mic. And I kind of
knew. You couldn't figure out.
Where the mic was. But I couldn't figure out the console, you know. How to go to audition, how to come back to program.
Yes.
I didn't figure out any of that stuff out. I didn't understand it. How to take a phone call, how to play the music.
How frustrated were you?
I was heavily frustrated.
But you still kept
it. But I was dreaming. You know, I had seen myself doing this, and I was finally so close. You know, I wasn't going to let one guy kick me out. And he wasn't the boss. I thought to myself, you know what? If I hang here long enough, somebody's going to teach me. And I still had that mentality. One day, somebody is going to mess up, and I'll be here to take their job. And
you know, your story just reminds me of Les Brown.
Yeah.
Les Brown's story.
Les Brown was an inspiration to me.
Yeah, back and forth the studio, somebody died, somebody, you know, until he got himself in.
Yeah.
Same story.
Yeah, so, I mean, I sat there, you know, watching, and then eventually one day out of the blue, the head of program said to me, you know what, it's time for you, you've been here for a long time. Time for you to have your own show. He threw me on the graveyard shift.
That's right.
Which is where all presenters start, you know. And I got there, but I hadn't learned anything.
Mm-hmm.
So my first day on the radio was a disaster.
As usual.
And this is why you have to be young.
There's
presenter.
A witness here. I slept off on my first.
Oh, yeah. Oh wow! Really?
Dozed off.
Oh
man.
Wow! Listen, young presenters out there, you've got to be grateful for the graveyard shift.
You know what?
So many mistakes.
It just is on. I'm enjoying it. I know you are. But let's take a quick break. And when we come back, I'm hanging out with IK. That's Ikumosa. Osakioduwa.
Wow, you're doing that to them, really?
Well, what can I say? Yeah? What can I say? Radio person, presenter, producer. He walks behind the scenes, in front of the scenes, everywhere. We're chatting with him, and a quick break. And when we come back, we'll take it to the top of the hour with what we've got. Stay with us. It's the men's room. Nice and sweet.
Nice.
I slept off on my first day. And by the time the engineer came in. All right, so welcome back. It's the men's room right here. Olumisi Adaba alongside IK. Okay, I wouldn't call him.
Yeah.
I should? Okay, maybe I'll let him call.
IK Osakioduwa.
There we go. And we're just chatting about, just having a conversation about him, life, work, profession, faith, and family, and all of that. And, you know, from which lessons can be picked on waiting, on things not just happening at the spur of the moment, but the need to wait, the need to be patient, the need to persevere. Now, before we went on break, we were on that long wait.
Yeah, frustrated.
And finally, the frustrated wait. And finally,
it switched.
Mm.
It switched.
You got your show.
Yeah, I got my show. I got a graveyard shift show. And I'm so grateful for the graveyard shift. Because if I had gotten the show which I wanted, which was, of course, the morning show, I don't think I would still be a radio presenter today.
You would have bungled it.
Yeah. My first show, I hadn't learned how to use the equipment.
That's right.
What I should have done, which I didn't do, was I should have asked one of the other presenters to let me sit on their shift as well, mm-hmm. so I could learn things. But I just sat down there thinking, oh, well, he won't let me do it, so I can't do it. Mm. Instead of being determined to learn one way or the other. So now I got the chance and I was on the show. And my first mistake, the DJ, there was a pre-recorded, 45-minute pre-recorded program going. And as the DJ saw me, he saw somebody who's been in the station for 6 months. Mm-hmm. You know, so he thought, okay, well, he must know what he's doing.
Yeah, he'll know what to do.
So he left, you know. And then I started seeing the counter was getting real close to the end, you know, and the security guard, God bless him, I don't know why he was sitting in the studio, but he was sitting there in the studio just watching me, like, oh, you're the new guy, okay, I'm just going to stay here and watch you. So I'm like, look, it's like 5 minutes left, can you get the DJ to come back and, you know, work with me here? And he was like, the DJ left about 45 minutes ago. I was like, oh my goodness, he's like, you're on your own. So you're starting your show in 5 minutes. Are you ready? And I started sweating in this AC place.
Yeah, the AC is on, but you're sweating.
And you know, once that pre-recorded program went off, I had dead air. So he's like, play music. You know, he was really like, play music. I didn't know how to do it. And then they used to play LPs.
Yeah.
You know, so I slapped one on. They were swearing. They were cursing. I literally ripped it off the LP. That noise, that scratching noise, I ripped it off. And then they had a CD player, a Numark CD player, and I said, okay, I'll play that. So I grabbed the CD, the closest one to me. I put it in. This was in around June, right? I put it in, press play. It was a Christmas song. You know, so it was a disaster. The mic was, I had switched the mic on talk. And I did not switch it off, so I was just like, oh my goodness.
All of that was going out to Lagos.
I was grateful that
Mayday.
Everything was going wrong. It was a terrible first show. I was so convinced when I would come in the morning that I would be fired. But luckily my boss had fallen asleep. And most of Lagos was sleeping at that time. It was like 3 a.m. So, you know, nobody really
Why it's actually a good time to
learn.
Yeah, to learn.
Yeah,
so good
every presenter should be grateful for the graveyard shift.
Yeah.
You make your mistakes in private and then come out on the other side of it better.
Come out shining. Yeah. Great, nice. And here you are doing all kinds of stuff, TV and radio and, you know, presentation, gigs, MCs, left, right, and center. You paid your price.
Yeah, I did.
Probably still paying.
I'm still paying some because I want to go further. You know, and there's always a price for the next level.
Oh, yes, indeed. Now, let's go back to family, but this time on a sad note. Now, in 2012, you lost your mom.
Yeah.
On your, not your birthday, but your
month. 3 days after. It was three days after my birthday.
How did that play out?
It was a bit, it was a terrible feeling for all of us. My mom was the typical big mama. She used to feed like all our friends, people like who would run away from home would come stay at ours. So my mom had like a bunch of kids. Well, there was always a group of people staying over at my house, relatives and non-relatives. And so when she passed, it was, she centered everybody. You know? So when she passed, it took us a while. You know, we had to figure ourselves out again. We had to relate with my dad in a new way, you know. And then we had to figure out how to relate with ourselves as well, because she was always the umpire, she was always the referee whenever we would fight. So that was tough for us. And then I was in the middle of Big Brother, you know, hosting Big Brother. I had been away on my birthday, so I didn't get to celebrate on my birthday. And then I came back, my wife had a dinner for me, they had dinner, and as soon as we got home, my phone rings. My brother, who was at the dinner, you know, I said, I wanted you to have a good time at the dinner. I didn't want to tell you then. I was sitting in the car, you know. I wanted you to have a good time at the dinner. I didn't want to mention then, but mommy passed away. You know, I was like, what? You know, it was the most traumatizing time of my life. I sat there thinking, God, you must be joking. You know, I like, if you've ever raised anybody from the dead, you're about to raise this woman up. I'm serious. It was the most, it was a strong time for me, you know. But it helped my relationship with God, it helped my relationship with the family, and it helped me realize things about life. Life doesn't last forever, so you have to do good while you're there. My mom's funeral for me was a huge lesson. You know, when we were burying her, people I had stopped talking to because we fought, you know, came for the funeral, and I was surprised to see them. And they, when they got a chance to speak, they said, you know, I'm not friends with you know, Ike, or we're not friends with whoever anymore. Mm. And but this was my mom too, you know, so they had to be there. Mm. And I thought to myself, that's who you should be. That's how life should be. You should live in such a way that you've done good, and when you're done and you leave, there's something good people have to say about you.
Yeah.
And their lives that have changed because of you.
Mm.
I kept discovering stories of people whose school fees she was paying, people who were reconciled to their families, friends of mine, you know, who were reconciled to their parents because she took them to the parents. And I was like, how was your friend? You didn't discuss this with me. You know, like, why didn't you tell me that your parents had kicked you out, you know? And it changed my perspective and I decided what kind of person I wanted to be.
Wow.
You know, that's important. Living life in of entertainment, you know, you've got to have something that centers you, or entertainment destroys you.
Exactly. And I was coming there on how you're able to pull this together, wear all the different hats, especially family. You travel a lot.
Yeah.
Even when you're not traveling, you're out and about, handling events here and there, and the radio show, the TV show. Then family comes in.
Yeah.
You've got kids, and then a beautiful wife. How do you balance it, and how do you make up for time lost, and how do you balance it?
You know, I've been a victim of not being in the midst of family, because my dad was in the army. He was always on transfer somewhere.
Mm.
At one point, we used to see him only twice a year, you know.
Twice a year?
Yeah, twice a year at some point in his career. And I remember vividly trying to make a decision whether to be an art student, social science, or a science student. And my dad had wanted me to be an engineer like everyone else in the family. Thinking my older brother, older sister engineers, younger sister an engineer. My dad had wanted all of us to go to that line.
Yeah.
You know, and I remember thinking, if I don't go with physics, I can't be an engineer. You know, if I go with social science, I don't know what I'll become. You know. And I remember struggling with that decision, but eventually deciding I'm going to go with social science was the decision I made. And I remember my dad came home shortly afterwards, looked at my report card, and he's looking through this report card, over scrutinizing it, and I'm like, what's the problem? And he says, where is physics? And I'm like, I dropped that, you know, almost last year. You know, I dropped that. He's like, how could you? You know? And I thought to myself, I don't want this to ever happen to me. I don't want to ever be so far removed from my kids' lives that they have to make big decisions and I'm not present to help. If I'm alive, then I want to be there, you know? So as far back as then, I decided I'm going to have to be involved with my family. So what I do mostly for my kids is I travel a lot, without a doubt, but when I'm around, I try to be hands-on out. Every now and then, try to do the homework with them. I'll try to drive them to school, see where their minds are, pick them up from school every now and then. And every now and then, I travel with them, you know.
As much as you can.
As much as I can. Wherever I can, I will travel with them. Sometimes I would even jeopardize school to spend a week with my kids. You know, so sometimes we'd be away, and maybe I didn't get to come away from work early. I will delay their going back to school sometimes by as much as a week. We would homeschool within that period just to have that interaction.
Yeah.
And sometimes I take them to work, you know, see where your school fees is coming from.
Exactly. I mean, I like that part. And behind the scenes, we were talking on exposing the children to some of these things we do. The other time I was up in the studio with my son, and it was a bit of a challenging one because, you know, can't keep a child still for a long time, and you want a quiet environment in the studio, but then he's moving. But he sees it, and even if he doesn't say anything, it's registering.
Yeah.
And like you did say, taking your son out to one of the gigs you had.
I decided, you know, one day I was going for one of my shows, and he says to me, can I come? Can I come? I'm like, I'm going to MC somebody's wedding. He's like, can I come? So I said to him, okay, no problem, dress up, let's go. So he came out in shorts and a t-shirt. I'm like, no, go back, dress up, like you're going to church or something. And he dressed up again, and then we went to the event, and I introduced him at the event. I was like, well, this is one of the gentlemen helping me at this event. If you have a message for me or there's anything you need to do that requires my attention, summon this young man, and he'll come to your table. And he was there standing with his hands behind his back, and when I referenced him, he would wave, and then put his hand back behind his
and
back.
And this is a seven-year-old? There we go. Not too early to start.
I've already started training him, and at one of my next events, he will introduce me. Yeah. Wow. So we've rehearsed it a few times at home just to see how it plays out. And that way he feels a little bit more involved and give him a feel of the mic, you know.
So. And some form of responsibility.
Yeah.
You know, just creeping in and it's never too early, guys. Never too early. Amazing. In fact, one of the things you said was when your kids misbehave, set them straight sharply.
Oh, sharply. Mm. Stop trying to be friends with your kids. I mean, it's nice to have a friendly relationship with your kids, but you're not their friend. Mm. You're a steward over their lives, which is a big responsibility. It's like being the boss of a company. You're not a friend to your staff. You can be friendly with them, but you have a responsibility to the company to make sure the company stays afloat, that the business keeps flowing, there's concurrency to the flow, so that you can pay their salaries when due. And so that also the day you're not around, they know what is right to do.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm a big believer in discipline and in being to your kids what exactly you're supposed to be to them.
Their father.
I see a father, exactly.
Authority figure.
You know, I see many problems today in society that I think just come from the lack of fathers.
Tell me about that.
I think fathers give identity, you know. Mothers build character a lot, but to know in yourself, I am a man. I am able to be responsible for my wife, my kids.
I need you to say that again. Fathers give
identity.
And mothers
give character. Yeah, so a mother is the one that will tell you, oh, be nice to your friends, don't do these things. You know, oh, this is not fair. This is equitable. This is not good. You know, but your father. So, for instance, in my home, my dad would never let my mom do certain things. Mm-hmm. Go put on the generator, change a light bulb.
Yeah.
No.
What for?
Yeah, what for? You know, he would pay all the school fees because in his mind, look, I'm a man. That's I'm right. responsible for this family. He would pay for the holidays, the things that constituted our living, he was responsible for. And so I grew up thinking this is the duty of a man. But my mother, on the other hand, taught us character. You know, so she would teach us greeting and how to greet appropriately.
Courtesy.
And she never stopped teaching us character and courtesy. Mm. Yeah, I remember buying a new car. My mom said, now that you've got this huge car and you're this small boy, you've got to be a lot more respectful. I'm like, what? I'm a respectful person. She's like, yes, but you know, people have a perception about money. Mm-hmm. Whenever you a rich person greets, they say he didn't even greet properly. So now you have to be, you have to bow your head when
like,
you greet.
It's like the extra effort goes into it.
You've got to make that extra effort. Mm. She's like, now you bow your head when you greet. You greet loud and clear for everybody to hear. Mm. You know, so
I grew up. And it makes a difference. It's like the icing on the cake.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it makes a world of difference, you know. And so I grew up with that understanding. A father must give his children identity. If a father tells his daughter she's beautiful enough,
that's it.
She will never have to get that endorsement from a man. She will never have to seek it from a man to believe it.
Preach it, preach it, preach it. Because I'm telling you, because right now we've got all kinds of people on the loose, basically because there's no figure, there's no father figure, there's the authority isn't there, you know, either physically or emotionally, you know. And so we have kids just misbehaving and going through their own motions. And sadly, because sometimes again, money making keeps us out of touch. You know, we're out, you know, just trying to make make the cheese and all of that, and by the time we're back home, the kids are sleeping. By the time we're up and running, they're still sleeping, you know. And that is an unfair balance.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
I wanted a big family. I wanted 4 children, you know.
You still working on that?
No, not anymore. My wife said something to me that completely changed my mind, you know. After my second child, my daughter Micah, she said to me one day, she was like, this girl is now 2 years old. In her entire life, how many times have you given her a bottle? And I could count how many times I've given her a bottle. So I thought to myself, really, I haven't had enough time for this child, not the way I had for my son. My son, I used to bathe, feed, and take him to school 4 times a week.
Deliberately.
Deliberately. Yeah. I was very involved. You know, but with my daughter, I didn't have as much time. Yeah, I had grown a little bit more in the industry and a lot more was being required of me, but I didn't have that much time for her. You know, so I made a mental note. If I've depreciated in my fathering so drastically by the second child, I'll probably be calling home to ask about the third child, you know, as he started walking. Yeah, oh, well done, you know, like,
yeah,
what's
we
he doing now?
We
I decided, no, I'm stopping at 2.
Great. And faith,
Faith plays a major role.
Talk to us about
faith. Faith plays a major role in everything I do because I was brought up in a strong Christian home. My granddad being the first born-again believer that I knew. My mom also growing up in a strong, with strong Christian beliefs. I mean, we went through the period where my parents were not big on faith for a while.
Yeah.
But then we came to a place where my mom had decided, I want to be serious about this and deliberate.
Mothers, yeah. Usually.
See?
They're ahead such.
So she did for a while. Eventually my dad got on the bandwagon as well. And it's put a spine in me, put something that gave my life structure.
Mm.
You know, it put a border and a boundary in my mind. So certain things were not just alien. If I ever managed to do them, they would feel wrong. So it has greatly shaped everything. And then later on in my life, I came into being deciding that this is something I wanted for myself as well, not just something that was being done to me by my parents. But yes. I wanted to be a person of faith. Yeah. I wanted to be a Christian. I wanted to be a believer. I wanted to be born again. I wanted to follow the same path that my grandfather and my mother had followed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so now today it plays such a huge role in the way I live. The industry is rough.
I was going to ask how you reconcile it or how you play it or practice it with the industry that we have today.
Oh, it's so rough. It's I remember my first few days in on radio. It was a tough period, a very tough period. There was a lot of flirting, a lot of sensuality about that, particularly my radio station. I remember there was this girl in the news department, for instance, who was flirting very aggressively with me at the time. I was a young boy. I didn't know that much about girls. I was innocent. And she would come in while I'm talking on the radio.
Yeah.
And she would lift up her top and just flash her breasts at me. And I would be traumatized, you know.
And
all my thoughts would go out the window. It would ruin my show,
oh
you
my
know.
Goodness.
And she was pretty. She was young. She was pretty. She was, I don't remember her name now, but she would do that to me consistently, you know. And for a while, what happened to me was because I hadn't by this time decided how serious I wanted to be about my faith, I became one of the boys. So all the things they were doing, maybe apart from drinking and smoking, but the womanizer, I did that for a very, very long time. You know, so because the entertainment industry just presents it to you.
It brings it on a platter of gold.
On a platter of
gold.
There
we are. Make your choice. Make
girls
your pick.
Call the radio station when we're done with the show and say, are you still in the studio? And we're like, yeah. They're like, wait, four of us are coming to see you. You know, we're like, why?
All
they're
four.
Like, we just want to see you. We like you. Mm. And they would come and they would be throwing themselves at you. It was quite a rough time, you know. But one day I sat down and I looked at my life and I had literally become one of the boys. I was doing all the things that I thought were wrong. All the things I hated about philanderers I had become.
Yeah.
And I thought to myself, no, this is not who I want to be. You know, and ended up in church somewhere and gave my life to Christ, or received the life of Christ. Because I was dead at the time, in my mind.
Dead. And how tough was it for you to
marry?
Make the transition? No, I mean, coming to
life.
Marriage, you
no,
did
no,
say.
No, I meant to marry the, faith within the entertainment industry.
Yeah.
Well, that was, it's still kind of tough, I won't lie to you.
It is.
Because there's some circles that are intimidated by your faith.
That's
you
right.
Know? I remember walking into a room with a friend of mine, and there were some of the biggest names in music in that room at the time, and he didn't mention that I was friends with all of them, all the boys in the room, but this friend of mine didn't mention to them that I was with him. You know, he was just like, let's go up and see this person.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, oh, sure. So we got up there and they had been doing coke, you know, so the white noses and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And they know I don't approve of it.
Yeah.
So they didn't want me to see and know that they were doing it.
Mm-hmm.
So they're like, oh, why didn't you tell us I was coming? And they're cleaning their noses and I'm looking at lines on tables. And I'm like, wow, I had no idea this was happening, you know. And so when I would find that whenever we would travel for shows or something, at some point, there would be some quiet gravitation to a silent
room, leaving you
on one side.
Yes.
And sometimes also, while they're doing all those things, they're also still doing business, you know?
Mm.
And the businessmen are more comfortable with those people who they've seen all their bad sides together. They all do the same things. They womanize and drink together. So sometimes you miss out on some business because you can't connect on a certain level.
But it's okay.
God always makes up.
Yeah, it's okay.
So I haven't missed the money, that those kind of money.
All right, we're wrapping up right now, and still going back to, you know, you, the girls, and all of that. Now, you did say that your wife was the only friend who seemed to get you and did not want to change you.
That's correct. Hmm. That is correct. She has always seen me and understood my giftings, my talents. She's always seen me and understood the kind of things I could be and do, you know. So she would always be like, no, but this is who you are. Just do it. Don't change it, just do it. Mm. If they like it, they like it. If they don't, they don't. But don't change who you are for people, you know. So I've always appreciated that about her. In terms of all the girls I could possibly have dated,
exactly,
she is only woman who I can say that I, even today, when I look at, and the options are many, you know, for every entertainer or person in public eye.
Yeah.
But even today, looking around, I don't think there's anybody that could replace her. Do you understand? She is a quintessential entertainer's wife. You know, she understands my gift, she promotes the gift, she encourages it, and, you know, she helps me to thrive in the world that we operate in without competing for the attention or, you know, trying to hold me back from it.
She works well from being behind the scenes.
Exactly.
Fantastic woman.
Amazing.
Thumbs up to you.
Thumbs
Alohi,
up to
right?
Her. Yeah, Alohi, yeah.
There we go. There we go.
Yeah.
What can I say? Thank you so much for coming.
Thanks for having me.
I still have tons of questions.
I love the men's room.
I wish we could go on and on. But well, we'll look forward to you coming back sometime
soon. I'll come back anytime you invite me to.
All right. Thank you so much. So did you enjoy? You did? My goodness. All right. Thank you for staying there. Thank you for listening. I'm Onimisi Adaba. You can follow us on Twitter at Men's Room OJ. Same address for the Facebook. Men's Room OJ, and share your thoughts, drop whatever you want. If you've got a topic, listen, if you want to listen to someone, just let me in on who the person is, and we'll work on possibilities of bringing the person to share his story, his life, and everything we need to know, all the things we need to know. Thanks again for coming, Aike. Appreciate
pleasure. It. Thanks so much for having
thank
me.
You for listening. Men's Room is over and out.
Please click on the red subscribe button below this video and subscribe to our YouTube channel.